Your Excellency, President Olusegun Obasanjo, former President of Nigeria, distinguished guests, students, colleagues, and members of the SMU community, and also to the group outside who couldn't join us in here, but in the overflow room, they can see us through video connection. Welcome to this lecture, this presidential lecture. I'm delighted to welcome you here this afternoon for what is the first presidential distinguished lecture in 2016. And as already was introduced, and you know, our speaker today is His Excellency President Olusegun Obasanjo, who served as President of Nigeria from May 1999 to May 2007. I should say this was a culmination of a life spent in the front line of African politics, I should say, not only Nigerian. But just to remind you, and I'm always feel a bit embarrassed, President, to go through a CV of somebody who's so well known. But since Africa is not that well known in Singapore, as I explained to you earlier on, I will go through some of the elements. You became president of the Federal Republic of Nigeria in 1999, following the demise of the military dictatorship of General Seni Abacha. Mr. Obasanjo's elected term in office was characterized by a transition back to democracy, a commitment to the rule of law, as well as economic and political reform. He worked to rebuild institutions that were wrecked by decades of neglect, repression, and mismanagement. This included the appointment of key reform-minded technocrats who were internationally respected leaders in their fields. Consolidation in the country's banking sector transformed it into one of the most dynamic industries on the continent, and the liberalization of the telecommunications sector has allowed Nigeria to become Africa's largest and fastest growing markets for information and communications technology. President Obasanjo also created the country's first Economic and Financial Crimes Commission, which secured in excess of 275 convictions, including high-profile members of Nigeria's elite, and recovering that way a total of $5 billion in assets. This was the first time in the country's history that public officials were prosecuted for the misuse of state funds. Partially benefiting from high oil prices, President Obasanjo's government oversaw a doubling of Nigeria's average economic growth rate to 6%. Foreign reserves rose during that time from $3.7 billion in 1999 to $45 billion in 2007. And sound economic stewardship helped him secure an $18 billion in debt relief from Western creditors, and his government used burgeoning state revenues to pay down a further $12 billion in dues, leaving Nigeria almost debt-free. After serving his country for 8 years and restoring the respect of its continental peers and the international community, he stepped down in 2007. But since then, he has been a sort of Africa's ambassador at large. His role as that ambassador at large has continued, and the continent assumes an increasingly central role in international policy and business. In 2008, President Obasanjo was appointed by the United Nations as a special envoy for Africa and has since overseen democratic elections on behalf of the African Union and the Economic Community of West African States in countries across the continent. He has since emerged as an advocate for investment into obviously his own country, but also the continent as a whole. Mr. Obasanjo has been a catalyst in driving Africa's economic transformation. I know that when we're sitting here in Singapore, we are always focused on China, but the growth in Africa has been tremendous, and we're talking about a huge continent with enormous opportunities. It's one of the reasons why I'm proud and very pleased to welcome you here today, because I find that it is the role of SMU as a leading university in business for the world of business and management to actually show some of the potentials that can be realized in Africa. Indeed, the region is now among the fastest growing in the world, rapidly becoming the destination of choice for international investors looking to emerging and frontier markets. Using his experience as a successful farmer and businessman in Nigeria, President Obasanjo is actively engaging this community to facilitate more investment into the continent. He will achieve this vision through the Africa Investment Council, a platform of distinguished leaders working to provide advocacy, thought leadership, collaboration, and best practices on sustainable investment into Africa. He also, as was already mentioned, established the Olusegun Obasanjo Foundation, a UK-based charity that has a mission of advancing human security for all. The foundation has wide-ranging initiatives of Feeding Africa, youth empowerment, education for girls, and a health initiative focused on non-communicable and waterborne diseases. President Obasanjo, I'm looking forward to hearing your comments. Obviously, not only your comments about Nigeria, although we know there was a new Nigerian cabinet was sworn in just 4 months ago, and there are a lot of expectations around it, but also your vision on what's happening in Africa. We just had what was not a Super Tuesday, but a Super Sunday, with elections ongoing in Africa, with lots of new people coming and existing presidents continuing their job. But I do believe that lots of things are ongoing in Africa. It is a continent that we know have to know much better. I'm looking forward to hearing your views on how these different governments, and in particular also the government in your own country, can bring in great economic growth and foreign investments to propel the world's newest continent, I should say, into the 21st century and making it a very wealthy and healthy continent. We agreed that President Obasanjo would speak for about 15 to 20 minutes, and then that we go into a dialogue, which I will lead, as was mentioned before. Hopefully there will be some questions from the people to whom I will wave now. We can't see them here, but who are sitting just outside watching the screen. Your Excellency, it's your floor.
The president of SMU, distinguished ladies and gentlemen, I want to thank you for going over that CV of mine that you've gone over. And because of the way you have gone over the CV of mine, it has helped, because some of the area that I will have covered, you have covered in giving my CV. It is my pleasure to be here with you today, and I thank you all for taking time out of your busy schedules to join us. My visit was rescheduled because of conflicts with concomitant engagements. I want to thank the SMU president and his staff for making the necessary adjustments. And I also want to thank my boss, Professor Leslie Obiora, who actually was with me for a short while on my cabinet. My address will be on the topic Nigeria's evolving transformation, and you have mentioned a bit of what we have done trying to transform our economy, trying to transform the social life of our people. But again, as you have requested, we'll have to speak with an emphasis on a broader topic, which underscores what is right with Africa. In doing this, because there may be in the audience, people who may not be too familiar with Africa. And of course, there will be those who are very, very familiar. And I have to try and strike a happy medium between boring those who know too much about Africa and enlightening those who may need to know a little bit of about Africa. My visit to SMU was planned on a continuum with a couple of lectures that were built around the question of what is right with Africa. And if I may just start from that point. Those of you who know, Africa was generally colonized by four main colonial, European colonial powers. Britain, and we in Nigeria, we share that similarity with you here. France, Portugal, and Spain. And when the flurry of independence started, I think the first country that actually got independence was Sudan in 1956, followed by Ghana in 1957. And by 1960, it was almost independence for all. And that was the year Nigeria got independence. It's also important that I should mention that independence did not come on a platter of gold. Some negotiated independence. Some actually got independence by what I call protestation. And some got independence through armed conflict. Now, I won't go into details of which one, maybe in the time of question and answer, we can deal with which one got what and at what time. Now, the political, economic, and social situation of all these countries, including even countries like Liberia and Ethiopia, which were never, strictly speaking, colonized. The economic situation were about the same for the colonial countries. The political division of which took place in Berlin in 1885 and 1886 was what we carried on until independence. And the colonial masters agreed among themselves, whatever I grab, I keep. And whatever you grab, you keep. That was the situation until we attained independence. And at independence, of course, we had a margin from Africa to sets of countries. The countries that I would call or were called moderate, those are the ones that were not radical leaders like Tubman in Liberia, like Emperor Selassie in Ethiopia, like Senghor in Senegal, and Houphouet Boigny in Côte d'Ivoire, or in fact, our own Prime Minister Taffare Balewa. They were regarded as moderate, and And they held a meeting in Monrovia, capital of Liberia. And they became what was called Monrovia Group. The more radical ones were leaders like Nkrumah, leaders like Julius Nyerere, like Lumumba, and they held their own meeting in Casablanca, and they were called Casablanca Group. That was the situation until they were able to meet and reconcile and form OAU in 1963. Now, if we are talking about what is right with Africa, I think the ability of our leaders to form a continental organization, in spite of their differences, in spite of the move and push and pull by the former colonial masters, I think was something that was right. It was the right decision, and they took it. Now, the rest of Africa since then, of course, what happened was that politically, we maintained and we, in fact, put in the charter of OAU that we must keep the colonial boundary, the inherited boundary from the colonial masters as sacrosanct. And that was no interference in the internal affairs of any other country, irrespective of whatever that country is doing or not doing. And that was the politics. The economy, I think particularly the radical countries or radical leaders felt, look, why should we continue with the economic inheritance or heritage of the colonial power? And of course, as you know, those were the heydays of bipolar world. Well, there's the capitalist and the socialist. Well, if we have emerged from the capitalist and we were colonized by the capitalist, well, should we continue to be with them? And especially if we have a choice. And well, most substantial number of African countries went the socialist way. And well, I don't believe that whether we went the socialist way or the capitalist way, we were not any better for it. At the end of the day, what was happening is that we were getting more of guns than more of than materials for our development, because they have started inter-African feud and crisis, and then also intra, particularly the effort of the those that were called guerrilla, that we call them freedom fighters, and they were the ones that were that got independence through what I call armed conflict. Now, what has happened in Africa since then? Well, we had spate of military coup. The feeling among the military elite was that, oh, the politicians were not doing well enough. And I must say this, not because my background was military. I think they were well-meaning but naive. And that is the experience that I will say about Nigeria. And not only were they naive, their good intentions did not last too long before they too fell into what you may call the trap of politics or the trappings of politics, either the trap of politics or the trappings of politics. So you then have those who believe that, well, one party system is what is good, those that did not go for military regime. But whether it's military regime or one party system, sooner than later, we found that really there's no alternative, particularly in countries that are diverse, either diverse in linguistic or in religion or in social level or in geography, whatever way the diversity is, really democracy is the best form of government for dealing with the contestations within the body politic in each country. Even before the fall of Berlin Wall, before the end of the Soviet Union, Africa had started to realize that socialism may not be the way. One party system may not be the way. Military regime may not be the way. So by the time that we came to the beginning of the 21st century, I think all those things that we saw 25 years before the end of the century, of the 21st century, as probably the right thing, we have realized that they were not the right thing, and we abandoned them. So we enter the 21st century with four things that are very important for Africa. One, we entered with, for the first time, an international, a global, or a UN devised program called MDG, Millennium Development Goals. It was the first time that we had that type of thing. Secondly, we entered with the African leaders themselves deciding that, look, whatever purpose we wanted OAU to serve, it has served it. And we need to transform from OAU to AU with a markedly different constitutive act, different from the OAU charter. Now, that was number two. Number three, for the first time, AU had a program, a continental program called NEPAD. We never had anything like that before. We tried and we never succeeded. That was number three. And coming out of that, something we call APRM, African Peer Review Mechanism, which allowed us among ourselves to be able to say, hey, this country, what you are doing is wrong. And within ourselves, we've never had anything like that. Now, these were what we got into the beginning of the 21st century with. Now, the Economist magazine in UK, which regarded at the end of the 20th century, which regarded Africa as a basket case, 10 years into the 21st Century came out with a banner headline, Africa Rising. Now, and you won't believe it, but oh yeah, the basket case is now rising. We are not rising. African lions have not been rising as much as Asian tigers, which you are one of. But I think we have started waking up from our slumber. We are not rumbling the forest yet. We will soon be rumbling the forest, but we are almost there. Now, I want to emphasize one thing. Africa is not a monolithic continent. And people always make that mistake. The distance from Senegal, Dakar, to Djibouti is almost 8 hours flight, nonstop. The distance from Cape Town in the south to Tripoli in the north is, in fact, about 9 hours. Now, that is the expanse of Africa. And then, of course, we have large countries, small countries, and medium-sized countries. Nigeria, my own country, which I will touch upon briefly, is the largest with a population of 187 million people. Then you have a country like Sao Tome Principe with 150,000. And then you have medium countries like Gambia with about 1.5 million. But after Nigeria, the next largest country is Ethiopia, and then Egypt, then of course South Africa. I thought I should mention this so that you have a sort of panoramic idea, if not view, of the situation in Africa. Now let me now come to Nigeria. At independence, we had three regions. Three lopsided regions, politically. And we had not. Now, before I come to Nigeria, let me just say one thing. What had made Africa to get to where we are? And with economists talking of Africa rising, is the reforms and the transformations that have taken place in all our countries, particularly reforms which have brought democracy. Good governance, I believe we'll get there. Some of our elections we still dispute, but I believe that a disputed election result is better than no election at all. And in our own sub-region of West Africa, last year we had 5 elections. Now, only yesterday, Benin Republic concluded their own election, and it was a bit of surprise for the result was a bit of surprise for even some people in Benin Republic itself. So economic reform, political reform, and social reform, education, particularly in the area of education, healthcare delivery, were things that we have taken seriously from the beginning of this century. and which had made a tremendous improvement in what we do and where we are and where we are going. Now, let me come back to Nigeria. As I said, at independence politically, we had three regions. Well, we had not much of anything we could call industry. Of course, the colonial power, like colonial power anywhere else, held the country together, held Nigeria together for their own purpose, exploitation of the wealth of the country for the metropolitan land. But it's not anything different from others. We needed, I believe the first thing we needed, which we did not take care of, is that our three regions that we took over at independence were lopsided, and we needed to do something about it. We didn't do what we needed to do about it. And so what did we have? Soon after independence, we had our political parties were regionally based. The two regions in the south were controlled by two political parties, and the region in the north was controlled by another political party. And what then happened was that to run the affairs of the country, of course, you need to have two of the political parties to come together. Invariably, it was the political party in the north and the political party in the east that came together. And part of the result of that was that the smallest region, the western region, was actually the one that was divided, and from where a fourth region was created, the Midwest region. Now, that didn't occur too well. That happened, but soon after that, we had a census in 1963. It was problematic because, of course, the census will determine the number of things. And we couldn't even agree to accept how many we are. So that was problematic. In 1964, we had election in the West. Again, it was problematic. In 1965, we have Thief Riot. This is a tribe in the North that was not it was not going along with the party in power in the north, and the military was called upon to put a heavy boot on the riot. Now, the nepotism, the corruption, and the lack of serious government, or a lack of serious good government in the center led, among other things, to a coup in 1966. Now, we tasted our first military coup in 1966, and that was not good for us because until that time, we have had one national economic development plan. And it was ongoing when the coup took place, and the coup led to another coup. And from the second coup, it led to a civil war. Well, that that diverted our attention from economic or social transformation or program or progress, and we had to face the issue of security, holding the country together. We succeeded, and by 1970, we managed to put an end to the Civil War, and we started thinking of a second economic development plan. At that time, central planning was in the vogue. Again, later on, we realized that really with market economy, government central planning, as we had it, was really not the way to go. So in 1971, we had a second national development plan. What was different in the 1971 plan was that it really took in socioeconomic development more seriously than the first plan. Social aspect, health, education, that was the first time we talk about free education nationwide. But there were still things that we did not do enough of. Now, let me move on quickly. We then had, in 1975, another coup. And between that particular coup, which brought me into government and some of my colleagues, worked hard and handed over to an elected government in 1979, where we established or re-established democracy. The man that took the that came into the helm of affairs, President Shagari, was a decent man, but he was too decent to be the leader Nigeria needed at that time. All social programs were reversed. Primary education was reversed or stopped. Primary health, which was instituted for the whole country, was stopped. Not much attention was given to economic progress, and except during the period of the government, of the military, one thing must be granted to the military, apart from, in spite of all other things, they created from the four regions they took over, they created 36 states. Maybe they have created too many states. But they have done one thing right. They have stopped or prevented the lopsided nature of our political administrative division, which was there at independence. So let me now quickly go on and say, well, between 1983, when Shagari was removed, and 1999, when, as you heard the president saying, I came in as elected president. It was like a musical chair, the military. One military will remove one, another one will come and remove another one, another. And it went on like that. It was so bad that they had no time, really, to look at the economic and the social issue that should be the occupation of a government. Now, that was the situation, and I must add what the president of SMU did not remember to say about me. I was sent to prison. I was sent to prison. This afternoon we had lunch with what do you call them? NYAA, National Youth Achievement Award. And they told us the story of a man who was in prison and for drug and gangsterism, and who then became completely changed and all that. And I said, well, what you must remember or know is that I was also sent to prison, not for drug or for gangsterism, but for saying to a military dictator that he had no right to be in uniform and be running the affairs of Nigeria. Well, that landed me in prison. Now, I came out of prison, and I contested the election, and by 1999, I was elected. Well, I think most of the things that was done under my administration in between 1999 and 2007 were covered by the president of SMU when he was giving his CV. But between 2007 and now, I think it's important to say that, again, we have reversed. My successor, who campaigned on the slogan of continuity, actually, when he took over, he established discontinuity. So, politically, between 1999 and 2000, between 2007 and 2016, I think two things have happened. We have been able to move politically from one regime to another, peacefully and without any incident. But between in 2015, we were able to move from one regime, incumbent regime, to opposition regime taking over and without any problem. There was fear that, oh yes, heavens would fall. People thought there would be a bang, but we didn't even have a whimper. So some of the measures that were taken before 2007 were reversed. Reserve that was left at 45 billion after we have paid all our debt went to as much as 62 billion by the end of 2007. That reserve now is well below 28 billion. And what we were saying is that, look, keep this reserve, build it up, because there will be a raining day. So they said to me that rains have started now, and they don't have to wait for the rainy day. They didn't wait for the rainy day. But it's now that the rainy day has come, and we do not have any umbrella over our head. Other thing, we had something we call excess crude. This is when we budget for, at the beginning of the year, we budget 10. Possibly the price of oil, and we get 12, that excess between 10 and 12, we keep aside. We build that up to 35 billion. And those who took over from us said, well, look, this rainy day has come, and excess group was demolished. It was used up. Now, I think the thing that only we can say is that we have sustained democracy and rule of law, and that is good. But generally, Nigeria's nation-building agenda has not prioritized inculcating patriotism as the cornerstone of statecraft. We try something we call National Youth Service Corps in Nigeria here, who is not as old as I am, must have gone through that. Those of you who were educated in Nigeria who have gone through National Youth Service Corps, please put up your hand. Oh, okay, all right. It's a modest recognition of the centrality of pipelining an orientation program to help instill patriotic values in youth of college, as youth of college graduates. Given the shortfall of the Nigerian government and the frailty of public confidence in its institutions, the popular consensus is that the youth are the primary predicate for Nigeria's viability and competitiveness, given the exigencies of the contemporary global economy. In fact, I personally feel very strongly that if we solve much of the physical, structural, cultural, and ideological problems facing Nigeria today, but fail to meet the needs of our youth, who are not merely our successor generation, but our dominant present, and who are the assets that we have, we will not considerably improve the status quo. It is on this note that I will focus the remainder of my speech or address to Nigeria's youth, with particular reference to the female cohort of this demographic profile. Notwithstanding the significance of the youth, youth unemployment rate has been assessed to be as high as 50%. If you think 50% youth unemployment is bad in a country of over 180 million, try to imagine how daunting the challenges will be by 2050, when at least 400 million people will inhabit Nigeria. And if you have 50% of them unemployed, well, good luck to you. Fortunately, I will not be here. On the eve of the 21st century, the World Bank commissioned a provocative study entitled, "Can Africa Claim the 21st Century?" A key finding of which was that Africa's wars are conflicts over resources. While ongoing democratic consolidation in Africa has stemmed the incidence of wars, the phenomena have also heightened awareness about the importance of equitable inclusion, fairness, justice, youth employment, and signal the strategic security ramification therefrom. I want to just finish on the note, let me mention an initiative of the Olusegun Obasanjo Presidential Library, which I started through its Center for Human Security. The center anchors and a strategic partnership with the Leadership Enterprises for African Development, LEAD, which was established by my boss, Leslie Biora, who, as I said, was on my cabinet. Despite the role of technology as a tool for alleviating tensions in the overarching context for security, women remain underrepresented in ICT. And one of the things that we are trying to do with this joint effort is to actually give youth skill that they require. But apart from that, pay special attention to girl child education. I will conclude with this preliminary thought about what do we do to achieve self-actualization or close the gender and digital gap. It must complement emergent global commitment to strengthen conditions to stimulate local agency as ways and means to rationalize joint security operations, democratize peace processes, and promote governance accountability. Let me stop at this point, since we will have question and answer, and I hope you will give thought to points, particularly this issue of youth empowerment, youth employment in your now dialogue that follows. This is especially because I am eager to enlist your specialist know-how and perhaps even your enriching wherewithal for our purpose, the purpose of not sitting on a keg of gunpowder in Nigeria and indeed in whole of Africa by continuing to have over 50% of our youth